My name is Margaret Cho. I am a stand-up comedian. I'm an actor. I'm a musician. I'm a writer. I'm an activist. I think all of these things, many more things. I was a sex worker. And I definitely write about my experience. And I write a lot about the experiences of sex workers because I think it's a really, it's a strange world that does not accept its oldest profession. And talk about essential work. This is essential work. It needs to happen. I think that I was very vocal about having been a sex worker and my feelings about the rights of sex workers, just because I was just tired of people have this idea that women couldn't possibly have agency about and around their bodies, about what they would like to do with their bodies, whether or not they would like to be sex workers. Of course, there is an element also in every area of oppression. There are bad situations, but there's also a huge population of people who are sex workers who do it by choice, who are skilled, who are really just kind of at, you know, having to deal with the laws where they are working and not having the support of activist organizations, not having the support they need, because sex work is hard work. We need workers' comp. We need understanding from the community. And I mean, we don't have any of those protections that any other worker would have. And it's like working construction. It's a physically demanding job. It's hard work. It's like, we need like workman's comp. We need like unions. It's a very overlooked arena of commerce. But so much goes on there, and also the societal stigma around sex work. When we need time off, you know, those are things that should be built into the business model of a sex worker. We should be able to take paid vacations, paid sick leave. You know, it's something like, you know, if a job involves your physical labor, having to kind of shield your work from law enforcement, but at the same time be a public figure. It's like, it's got to be really, it's very taxing on top of the physically taxing nature of sex work to begin with. To have this place where we can have a community of women or people who are working as sex workers protecting each other. I didn't really feel like I had a community as a sex worker because we were so kind of removed. We were kind of dealing with a new technology, which was telephones. It's very like, I was a phone sex worker, phone sex operator. So that is like, I mean, when that technology was like new, which is so funny to think about. And so it was very much like this new frontier of where sex work can go or what it can be. It wasn't a part of my experience to reach out to organizations, although I know that they existed. Of course, in San Francisco, we had different sex worker alliances, and there were also kind of these work collectives built around the Lusty Lady, which I always thought was really cool because it was very queer, very alternative, and I always thought that was so awesome. So I think that there's just... I wasn't in it long enough to really be able to reap the benefits of it. I'd have been older and kind of been in it longer and known more about the politics of what was happening. I was just so unaware. It's just important for us to be able to have places where we can feel safe together and have places where we can really, you know, just discuss the nature of the job. I mean, this helps me in all arenas, in every area that I work. Like when I do music, it's really helpful for me to talk to musicians. That can be a very physically taxing job. And so if you get a job with like a symphony, they're going to like help you. You will get some like care for tendonitis or carpal tunnel or things that are affecting your work in that way, you know? So there's like a way to feel better at your job. The job is better served when there's communities that spring up around it where the workers can connect to each other. These traditions, these stories, it's like we need to hear about sex work, you know, surviving it and thriving in it. It's really powerful.